Good morning, boys. Today we are going to discuss on current electricity. And today's topic is Ohm's law, electric power, heating effect of electric current. So, as we have discussed in the previous video, that electric current is the flow of charge per unit time. And it is a revision of the previous class, that current is equals to Q by T, where Q is the quantity of charge and T is the time. And here I is the current, and hence the SI unit of current is ampere, which is coulomb per second. The electric current is measured by ammeter, and it is always connected in series in a circuit. Ideally, a current source must provide a constant current for any load. That means if we change the load, the current should be constant for throughout the time, as shown in here. If we change the external resistance or load, then the potential difference will change across the two terminals of the load, but current must be constant. So in the VI curve, it is a straight line parallel to the potential axis. The concept of conventional current is also discussed in our previous video. That is, in conventional method, the current is supposed to be the flow of positive charge, and that is, the flow of positive charge begins from higher potential to the lower potential. But in the modern concept, it is supposed to be the flow of electron or free electron. Hence, it is the flow of electron from negative terminal to the positive terminal. Drift velocity and current. What is drift velocity? Drift velocity is the velocity of the free electron with which it is drifted towards the positive terminal. So drift velocity equals to acceleration into time, and acceleration, as you know from the Newton's second law, that is force by mass. So here the force on the electron is E into capital E. Here capital E is the electric field between the two terminals. Now, what is electric field? Electric field is the amount of force on a unit positive charge. So, here the charge of electron is E. Hence, the total force will be E into E. So, total force by mass, that equals to the acceleration of the system. We can show that the current must be equals to the NEAVD, where N is the number of electron per unit volume, which is termed as electron density, and E is the charge of the electron. As we know, velocity is equals to length by time. So here we can write VD equals to L by T, time taken to cover the length. Then the expression becomes NEAL by T. Hence, A into L becomes volume, and when it is multiplied with N, then we get the total number of electrons in that volume, and it is multiplied by E. E is the charge of electron, so we get total amount of charge in this volume, and it is also divided by T, so we get total amount of charge in the numerator part and the time in the denominator part. So total charge by total time is equals to current. So the relation of current with drift velocity is I equals to NEAVD. Now, as we have discussed in the previous video, electric potential and potential difference. The potential difference is measured between the two ends of a circuit element when current is passing, but when current is not flowing, then the potential difference will be zero. As we said earlier, in open circuit, there is no potential difference across any circuit element. In another term, we can say that the potential difference between two points is the amount of work done to bring a unit positive charge from one point to another. So here potential difference is work done by charge, and its unit becomes 1 volt, which is equals to 1 joule per 1 coulomb. It is measured by voltmeter. voltmeter is always connected in parallel across the two points between which the potential difference is to be measured. Now, for an ideal voltmeter, it should provide a constant voltage in difference with the external resistance. That means, if we change the external resistance, the voltage of the voltage source must provide a fixed amount of voltage across the circuit. A electric circuit is a continuous and closed path of an electrical current. Here, in this circuit, a cell, a bulb, an ammeter and a plug key is placed and connected through a connecting wire. And it is a closed path, and from this closed path, the current should flow from this positive terminal via bulb and ammeter to the negative terminal if the key is closed. And if the key is open, then the circuit will be open circuit and there will be no current in this circuit. Here are few symbols of components which is used in electrical circuit. Like this is an electrical cell is represented by a long line with a short line. The long line represents positive terminal and the short line represents the negative terminal. When we place two or three long line with short line, then it represents a battery or combination of cell. This is a plug key and this is a switch, and in this case these are opens and these are closed. This is a closed switch and this is a closed plug key. This is a diagram of valve and this is a diagram of resistance, and this is the rheostat or variable resistance can be represented by these two symbols. Ammeter is represented by a capital A with a circle, and a voltmeter is represented by a capital V within a circle. And a joint wire, that means a wire is joined from this, is represented by a point. And wire crossing over without joining is represented by a curved path. Here another chart of some electrical components. Now, what is current density? The current density at a point within a conductor is the current through a unit area of conductor around a point, provided the area is perpendicular to the direction of the flow of the current. Current density J equals to I by A, current per unit cross sectional area. So N, as we know, I equals to N E A V D. So A and A cancel out, so it becomes N E V D. So in vector form, I equals to J dot A. J means current density and A means area through which current is flowing. Now, Ohm's law. The electric current flowing through a conductor is directly proportional to the potential difference across the two ends of the conductor. When temperature and other physical conditions remains constant, that means in this circuit, if we increase the potential, the number of cell, the current in this circuit will increase. To increase the current in this circuit, we have to increase the potential. So, we can write it mathematically as V proportional to I or V equals to Ri. When proportional symbol is replaced by equals to sign, a constant term R is multiplied. Here, R is a constant and this is the V versus I graph for Ohm's law or for a conducting wire. It must be a straight line passing through the center. That means with the increase in potential, current will increase, but resistance remains constant. The slope of this graph, that means you can say it other way, the angle of this graph remains constant, which represents resistance of the circuit. Now, what is resistance? Resistance is the property of a conductor to resist the flow of current through it. So, according to Ohm's law, we can write it R equals to V by I. The SI unit of resistance is Ohm. So, the definition of 1 Ohm is that if the potential difference across the two ends of a wire is 1 volt, that means V equals to 1 and the current flowing through it is 1 ampere, that is I equals to 1 ampere. That means V equals to 1 and I equals to 1, then the resistance R of the conductor is 1 by 1 equals to 1, that is 1 ohm. From this equation, you can see that if potential difference or the source of or the voltage source remains constant, then current through the resistor is inversely proportional to the resistance. That means if we increase the resistance, then current will decrease. If we twice the resistance, then current will be half of its previous value. As we have discussed, that resistance means property to resist the flow of current. So if we increase the resistance, so it will resist more, so the flow of current should be less. Now, factor on which resistance of a conductor depends. The resistance of a conductor depends upon length, area of cross section and material of the conductor. This picture, if we increase the length of a conductor, then resistance will also increase. So, resistance is directly proportional to the length of the conductor. You can compare the flow of current with the flow of water. So, if the water has to flow a long distance, then its speed will decrease. Or, in other words, we can say that if the charge has to go a long distance through a conductor, then it will face more resistance. So, with the increase in length, the resistance increases. As you can see, the cross-sectional area of A2 is more than the A1. And you can consider this as the flow of water, that if the cross-sectional area of the pipe is more, then the water can flow through it easily. Hence, we can say that if the cross-sectional area of a conducting wire is more, then current can flow through it easily. So, resistance will decrease. So, with the increase in cross-sectional area, resistance will decrease. So, we can say that resistance is inversely proportional to the cross-sectional area. Resistance also depends on temperature. With the increase in temperature, the motion of the charged particle will increase. And with the increase in motion of the charged particle, they will collide with each other vigorously. Hence, the velocity of the charged particle decreases. Hence, the rate of current will decrease. So, resistance will increase. So, we can say that with the increase in temperature, current decreases and resistance increases. And the last point is that it depends on the material property. If we change the material, then according to the material's property, the resistance also changes. As in this chart says that silver has the minimum resistance and copper has the second minimum resistance. And as we go up, resistance of the material increases. So, as we have discussed earlier, that R is proportional to length, that is, with the increase in length, R is increases. R is inversely proportional to area, that is, with the increase in cross-sectional area, resistance decreases. So, from the combining these two, we get R proportional to L by A, and replacing proportional sign with equals to, we get R equals to rho L by A, where rho is a constant of proportionality called resistivity of the material conductor. Now, SI unit of resistivity is ohm meter. As from here, rho equals to, we can write rho equals to R into A by L. So, L is length, so its unit will be meter, and A is the area, so its unit will be meter square. So, R into meter square, R means ohm, so unit of resistivity will be ohm into meter square by meter, and so meter cancel out 1 meter from meter square, then it remains ohm into meter. Conductors like metals and alloy have low resistivity because they are conductors and their conductivity is high, so they can conduct high amount of electricity. But in case of insulator, their resistivity is high, so or conductivity is less, that means they cannot conduct electricity. The definition of resistivity is the resistance of a unit cube conductor is known as resistivity. That means unit cube means a cube with its length, breadth and height as 1 or unity. So length is equals to 1 and the area should also be 1. That means 1 by 1 equals to 1. So this term vanishes and R is equals to rho. That means the resistance must be equals to resistivity when the conductor is a unit cube. And also, resistivity does not depend on the length and cross-sectional area of the material. It is a material property. So, with the change in material, rho changes. Otherwise, rho remains constant. This is the resistance color code. It is used to calculate the value of resistance by using this color code. So, in the next slide, we can see that here four resistance are given with different color band. In one resistance, there are four color band, and in the last band, there must be a golden or silver band. This golden or silver band represents tolerance, as shown in here. The fourth band, this should be gold or silver or no band. If there is gold or silver, gold means 5% tolerance and silver means 10% tolerance. That means there should be a change of 5% or 10% in their resistance. If the resistance of a resistor is 100 ohm and there is a gold band, that means the value of the resistance can be in between 95 to 105. So now try to calculate the first resistance, the value of the first resistance. So here the first band is green and the second band is brown. So the first color should be the first digit and second color should be the second digit. So as the first color is green and the second color is brown, so it will be 51, and the third color is red. So third color is red, represent 2. It is the multiplier, that means 10 to the power 2. That means it should be multiplied by 10 to the power 2. So the resistance become 51 into 10 to the power 2, that means 5100, that means 5.1 kilo ohm. And as here a gold band in the fourth band, so it has a plus minus 5% tolerance. In the second, the first band is gray, second is red, and third is yellow. Gray, red, and yellow. So gray means 8, red means 2, so 82, and yellow means 4. So 82 into 10 to the power 4, and 82 into 10 to the power 4 means 820 into 1000, that is 820 kilo ohm. As here the fourth band is silver, so it has a plus minus 10% tolerance. And in the it is yellow, violet, and black. So yellow, violet, and black. Yellow means 4, violet means 7, so 47, and black means 0. It is 47 ohm. And as the fourth band is silver, so it has a plus minus 10 tolerance. So you must calculate the resistance of the fourth one. Now, in this topic, we are going to discuss about internal resistance of a cell. What is the internal resistance of a cell? That means a cell or a battery is made by some materials, and when current is flowing through that material, there should be a resistance inside the cell. This type of resistance, which acts inside a cell due to its material, is known as internal resistance of the cell. As the resistance acts internally, so it is known as internal resistance. The factor affecting internal resistance of a cell, the larger the separation between the electrodes, more the length of the electrolyte through which the current has to flow. Consequently, higher value of internal resistance. As we have discussed earlier, that the resistance depends upon the length and directly proportional to the length. So here, with the increase in length between the two electrodes, the value of the internal resistance increases. Greater the conductivity of the electrolyte, lesser the internal resistance. That is, with the increase in conductivity, which is inversely proportional to the resistivity, so resistance will decrease, and it will depend on the electrolyte used inside the cell or the battery. The internal resistance of a cell is inversely proportional to the area of the electrodes. As we have discussed earlier, with the increase in area, the rate of flow of charges or current increases. If we consider this circuit and this is a battery with EMF E and a internal resistance of R, and this battery is connected with an external resistance capital R, then we can write the total EMF must be equal to the total potential difference, and due to this E equals to the external potential difference causes due to the external resistance, and the small potential difference which is causes due to the internal resistance. So E equals to V plus V. Hence, as we know from Ohm's law, V equals to I into R. As I current is flowing through the circuit, so I current is flowing through the capital R and also through the small r. So to calculate the potential difference between the two ends of capital R, we have to multiply I into R, and to calculate the potential difference across the small r, we have to multiply I into small r. So as here capital V is the potential difference between the two ends of capital R, so it is replaced by I into capital R, and small V is the potential difference across the two ends of small r, so it is replaced by I into small r. So I is taken as common, so it the expression becomes I into R plus R. Now rearranging the expression, we get I equals to E by R plus R, and this is the expression of current in the circuit. Now here the term IR is the potential difference across the two terminals of the external resistance. As we have said earlier, this I into small r term, it is known as the lost volt of the battery. That means an amount of potential is lost due to the internal resistance of the cell, and this EMF or this potential is known as lost volt. As you have seen that a pencil battery which is used in remote or wall clock is of 1.5 volt. When we connect a voltmeter with its two terminal, then it will measures a potential difference of 1.1 volt. Then the question arises, if the EMF is 1.5 volt, then why the potential difference between the two ends is 1.1 volt? This is because an amount of potential is lost due to the internal resistance of the pencil battery, that is 1.5 minus 1.1 equals to 0.4 volt, which is termed as lost volt. So in this example, the amount of lost volt is 0.4 volt and the potential difference is 1.1 volt. Here is a difference between EMF and potential difference, which we have discussed in our previous video. Now, when we connect more than one EMF in series, then we have discussed in our previous video that total EMF is added. As here, three cells of EMF E are connected in series, so its total EMF will be 3E, and here which is represented by NE, as here N number of battery are connected, and the total internal resistance will be R plus R plus R, should be NR. So total resistance of the circuit will be NR plus capital R, as the external resistance is capital R. So the current will be NE, the total potential or total EMF, by total resistance, NR by NR plus R. If R is less than NR, that means the external resistance is very much less than the internal resistance, or in other way, the total internal resistance is much more greater than the external resistance, then the current is E by R. So when the internal resistance is negligible, that means NR less than R in comparison to the external resistance, then the cells are connected in series get maximum current, as we can see here. In this case, the amount of current is more than this, as here E is multiplied by N. So when cells are connected in parallel combination, the total EMF should be E, as all the positive terminals are connected in one place and all the negative terminals are connected in another place. So the total EMF of the cell should be E, and total resistance should be R by N. And how this becomes R by N will be discussed later. The total resistance of the circuit is R by N plus R. By simplifying, we get the equation of current I equals to total EMF E by total resistance R by N plus R. And by simplifying this equation, we get NE by nr plus r. In this case, when external resistance is negligible, the amount of current is greater. But in the previous case, when they are connected in series, when the internal resistance is negligible, it gets maximum current. So, in case of series connection, the resistance, internal resistance of the battery must be less to get maximum amount of current. But in case of parallel combination, the external resistance should be less compared to the internal resistance of the battery to get maximum current. Now, when resistors are connected in series combination, that means when the first resistance is connected to the second resistance and the another end of second resistance is connected to the one end of third resistance. When we connected in this way, this type of connection is known as series connection. Here three resistances are connected to give you an example of series connection, but you can add infinite number of resistance in this way. As we considered, the flow of current is similar to the flow of water, and in this case you can see that this is one pipeline, and so the flow of water through all the pipes should be same. That means the current through each resistor should be same. That means if the current passing through 3 kilo ohm resistance is I, then the current passing through 2 kilo ohm should also be I, and through 1 kilo ohm resistance should also be I. So in this case you have to remember that current through all the resistance in series combination must be same. So according to Ohm's law, as current is same through all the resistance in the circuit, but it will produce different potential difference across different resistance. Like it will produce potential difference V1 across resistance R1 and potential difference V2 across resistance R2 and potential difference V3 across resistance R3. And if we add three potential difference V1, V2 and V3, we get the total amount of potential V. We have written here V equals to V1 plus V2 plus V3. According to Ohm's law, V equals to IR. Hence V1 equals to I into R1, V2 equals to I into R2, and V3 equals to I into R3, which I have written here. So by putting the value of V1, V2 and V3, we get IR1 plus IR2 and IR3. And as you can see that I is common here, so we write it like V equals to I into R1 plus R2 plus R3. But if we replace all the three resistance with a equivalent resistance RS, but keeping the potential and the current in the circuit same, so we can write it V equals to I into RS. So comparing to V equals to I into RS and V equals to I into R1 R2 plus R3, we get RS equals to R1 plus R2 plus R3. So when we connect the resistance in series, then total resistance of the circuit increases. Hence the flow of current will minimize. Now here is an example of series resistance calculation. Calculate the equivalent resistance for the circuit which is connected to 24 volt battery, and also find the potential difference across 4 ohm and 6 ohm resistance in the circuit. So we have to calculate first the equivalent resistance of the circuit. So to calculate the equivalent resistance, we have to add R1 and R2, as we have seen in our previous slide. That is, equivalent resistance is equal to the sum of the R1, R2 and R3. As in this case, here is two resistance, so we have to add these two resistance to get the equivalent resistance. So equivalent resistance RS equals to 4 ohm plus 6 ohm equals to 10 ohm. And to find the potential difference across R1 and R2, we have to find the current I. And to find current I, according to Ohm's law, V equals to IR. So I equals to V by R. So we need to find the potential V. Here potential is 24 volt and R is the total resistance, that is 10 ohm. That is the current in the circuit V by R equivalent. V is 24, R is 10. So the total current I is equals to 2.4 ampere. So potential difference across R1 is V1 is equals to I into R1, that is 2.4 into 4, that is 9.6 volt, and V2 equals to 2.4 into 6, that is 14.4 volt. And if we add these two potential, we get 24 volt. So in the next case, when we add some resistance in parallel, then parallel connection means one side of all the resistance are connected at one point and other side of all the resistance are connected in one point, and this kind of connection is known as parallel connection. And in case of parallel connection, the potential difference across all the resistance are same. As in case of series connection, current through all the resistance was same, but in this case, the potential difference across the two terminals of all the resistance will be same. That is, if the potential difference across the two ends of the 3 kilo ohm resistance is V, then the potential difference across the 2 kilo ohm resistance will also be V. The potential difference across 1 kilo ohm resistance will also be V. So, like the flow of water, here the water is flowing through one pipe and divided into three different pipes. So the amount of flow of water in all the pipes will not be same. So to get the total amount of water, so we have to add the flow of water of all the pipes. Similarly, in this circuit, the current through the first, second and third are not same. Let the current through the first conductor or first resistance is I1, second is I2 and third is I3. So if we add I1, I2 and I3, then we get the total amount of current which is flowing through the battery. As we see, the total current is flowing here is I, which is divided among the three different resistance, that is I1, I2 and I3. So I1 must be equals to V by R1 according to Ohm's law. V equals to IR, so from there I equals to V by R. So I1 must be equals to V by R1, I2 must be equals to V by R2 and I3 must be equals to V by R3. As in case of parallel connection, the potential difference is same for all the resistance. So here for all the resistance, potential difference is taken as same V. So in this equation, I equals to I1 plus I2 plus I3, we put the value of I1, I2 and I3 and we get V common, and 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. Now if we replace 3 parallel resistance with one single resistance RP, then the current through the circuit I equals to V by RP. And if we compare these two, then V and V cancel out and we get 1 by RP equals 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3. So when the number of resistance are connected in parallel, the total or equivalent resistance is smaller than their individual resistance. You will be surprised to know that all household appliances are connected in parallel connection, so that when one appliance is turned off, the other appliances can be used. But if we use series connection, then if we cut off one connection by one appliances, then it will turn off the other appliances as the circuit is opened. Now another example of parallel combination. Here we have to calculate the equivalent resistance, and as we learned earlier that 1 by parallel resistance equals 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2 plus 1 by R3 and so on. So in this case there are two resistance, one is 4 ohm and one is 6 ohm like earlier. So we have to calculate 1 by RP equals to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. So 1 by 4 plus 1 by 6 and their LCM will be 12, and by adding the numerator we get 5. So RP equals to 12 by 5 or 2.4 ohm. So the current in this circuit will be I1 equals to V by R1 that is 6 ampere and I2 equals to V by R2 that is 4 ampere. So total current in this circuit I equals to I1 plus I2 equals to 6 ampere plus 4 ampere equals to 10 amperes. But we can find the total amount of current by total potential by total resistance. So 2.4 by 12 into by 12 by 5 will also get 10 ampere. Now another example, when two resistors are connected in series and parallel, their equivalent resistance become 15 ohm and 56 by 15 ohm. That means when they are connected in series, their equivalent resistance is 15 ohm, and when they are connected in parallel, their equivalent resistance is 56 by 15 ohm. Find the individual resistance. So now we know that for series resistance, the equivalent resistance is R1 plus R2 and the value of the equivalent resistance is 15. But in case of parallel resistance, the equivalent resistance is R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. By simplifying this equation, 1 by Rp equals to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. By LCM, we get in the denominator R1 and R2 and in the numerator R1 plus R2. So by inversing this equation, we get Rp equals to R1 R2 by R1 plus R2. As you can see, so R1 plus R2 equals to 15 ohm. So if we replace this R1 plus R2 by 15, then we get R1 R2 by 15 equals to 56 by 15. By cancelling the 15 and 15, we get R1 R2 equals to 56. So R2 equals to 56 by R1. Now from equation 1, R1 plus R2 equals to 15, we replace the value of R2, 56 by R1. And by simplifying this, we get R1 square plus 56 by R1 equals to 15. We get a second order quadratic equation. By solving this, we get R1 minus 8 into R1 minus 7 equals to 0. Now, if we put R1 equals to 8, then in the equation 1, then we get R2 equals to 7. And if we put R1 equals to 7, then we get R2 equals to 8 ohm. So the value of the two resistance must be 8 ohm and 7 ohm. In this example, here 6 resistance are connected. So to solve this, we first have to solve it part by part. So in the first part, we are solving these two resistance. So here these two resistance are connected in parallel, so we write it here 1 by Rp1 equals to 1 by R1 plus 1 by R2. Here both the resistance are same, so 1 by 2 plus 1 by 2 that is 2 by 2 that is equals to 1 ohm. So the resistance of the first combination, the first part, is 1 ohm. So in the second part, we replace the two resistance by their equivalent resistance is 1 ohm. Now in the part 2, we are going to calculate the equivalent resistance of these two resistance. So here 1 by Rp equals to 1 by 4 plus 1 by 4. So 2 by 4 equals to, so therefore Rp equals to 2 ohm. Now we are going to replace these two resistance by their equivalent resistance of 2 ohm. This must be, there is an, this is 2 ohm. So this resistance would be 2 ohm. It is mistakenly written as 6 ohm. So it is 2 ohm and this is 1 ohm. And now we are going to calculate the third part. that is 6 ohm and 6 ohm in parallel, so it becomes 3 ohm. So as we replace these three resistance, one is 1 ohm, second is 2 ohm and third is by 3 ohm. So these three resistance are connected in series, so we are going to apply the formula of series, apply the formula of equivalent resistance of series. So R equals to equivalent resistance, R equals to RP1 plus RP2 plus RP3. So the total circuit becomes R, that is 1 plus 2 plus 3 equals to 6 ohm. So in the first circuit, as you have seen, there are 6 resistance, they are connected in parallel and series combination, but after solving it, we get one single resistance, that is of 6 ohm, which replace all the circuit elements or the resistance in the circuit. But the current through the circuit and the potential difference across the two terminals A and B must be remains same. That means when we replace 6 ohm, when we replace all the 6 resistance by 6 ohm, the current and the potential difference of the circuit remains same. Now here is another example, and in this example you can see here is 5 resistance where 4 sides of the resistance are 1 ohm each, and in between C and D the resistance is 5 ohm. So we have to calculate the equivalent resistance between A and B. To calculate the resistance of this type of configuration, first we have to check the ratio of the resistance of AC and BC. As here 1 and 1, it becomes 1 is to 1 with AD and BD, that is also 1 is to 1. As the ratio are same, that is here also 1 is to 1 and here also 1 is to 1. So the 5 ohm resistance should be removed because the potential difference between C and D point is 0, and hence no current will flow through 5 ohm resistance. As the potential difference between C and D is 0, so these two points are same, so we can consider 1 ohm and 1 ohm are parallelly connected to a point, and another 1 and 1 ohm parallelly connected to a point B, and the configuration becomes like this: A point, and as the C and D points are equal, as the potential of C and D points are equal, so these two points are represented as one point. So 1 ohm is connected to C and another 1 ohm is connected to D, and again from C 1 ohm resistance is connected to B, and from D 1 ohm resistance is connected to B. So the circuit becomes like this, and in this circuit you can see here 2 parallel combination and here another 2 parallel combination. If we calculate the equivalent resistance of these 2 1 ohm resistance, then we get 1/2, and from this side we get also another 1/2. These two half ohm resistance are connected in series. These two half ohm resistance are connected in series. So by adding these two, we get the total equivalent resistance, that is half plus half, that is 1 ohm. So the equivalent resistance of this circuit is 1 ohm. Now we are going to discuss about electrical energy and electrical power. So in this topic, electrical energy is the work done to maintain the flow of current through the conductor. So energy is equal to the work done. That means work done equals to, we know, Q into V, because V means potential, and we discussed that potential is the amount of work done to bring unit positive charge. So for unit charge, the work done is V, or the potential. So for q amount of charge by unitary method, we get q into v. Now, as current I equals to q by t, so by rearranging, we get q equals to I into t. If we replace the q by I into t, we get w equals to I into t into v. Now, we know according to Ohm's law, v equals to IR. So, by putting v equals to IR, we get I into I, so I square RT. So, total work done is w equals to I square RT. We can write it in another way, that is v square by R into T or VIT. So, the unit of electrical energy or any type of energy is joule. According to Joule's work energy theorem, work done must be converted into heat or heat must be converted into work. So, W is proportional to H, and by replacing proportional sign with equal sign, then we get W equals to JH. Now, rearranging, we get H equals to W by J or I square RT by J. From this equation, H equals to I square RT by J, we can write H proportional to I square RT, and from which we get the Joule's law of heating. There is three law, and we can write it from this equation that H is proportional to I square when R and T are constant. That means the amount of heat produced is proportional to the amount of current flowing through the circuit when resistance and time of flow remains constant. Again, amount of heat is proportional to resistance when current and the time of flow in the circuit remain constant, that is H proportional to R when I and T are constant. Number 3, H is proportional to T, that is amount of heat is proportional to time when current and resistance in the circuit remains constant. So, we can write it in another way, I square RT or VIT. So, electrical power will be work done by time, as the power is the rate of work done. Now, T and T cancel out, so power becomes I square R or VI. SI unit of power is watt, or you can write it joule per second. Another unit of power is horsepower, and 1 horsepower equals to 746 watt. Definition of 1 watt. 1 watt is the power when 1 ampere current flows across a potential difference of 1 volt. That means when the potential difference becomes 1 volt, and if the current flows through the circuit is 1 ampere, then the power will be said as 1 watt. 1000 watt equals to 1 kilowatt. 1 kilowatt hour, which is the unit of electrical energy, 1 kilowatt, kilo means 1000 watt, into hour means 3600 seconds, so it becomes 3.6 into 10 to the power 6 joules. It is the unit of energy which is equal to 3.6 into 10 to the power 6 joules. It is the commercial unit of electrical energy, watt hour or kilowatt hour or BOT. When one unit of electrical current is consumed, that means when an instrument of 1 kilowatt or 1000 watt of power is used for 1 hour. The questions and the problems related to this topic will be discussed in the next video. Thank you. And don't forget to like and subscribe our channel.